Okay, so first of all, every time I tell people, anyone, that I do believe, like I am a feminist, I always say that what that means is that I believe in equality. And I believe, so when you say things like, if feminism didn't exist, there would be no change. Like, I feel like because like these radical feminists, like I don't agree with violence of any kind. Mm. Like I believe, I hate war. I'm a complete pacifist. I believe that all beings, not even just humans, deserve protection and safety. That's what I believe. And I'm also a feminist because I believe in equality. I believe that regardless of your gender, it's your choice, and that we, all beings that breathe, need safety. So I feel as though like your treatment of the word feminism really alienates anyone who identifies themselves as a feminist or even likes anything about feminism, because those radical feminists, like feminism is a movement. It has more than just those radical feminists. Like I would never do anything violent. In fact, like I can tell you that I've never, ever harmed any sort of like male or female in my entire life. And I identify myself as a feminist. So I feel when you say, when you use the word feminist as just a symbol for the radical feminists, like you're alienating the population of people that believe in equality and also call themselves feminists. So do you feel like that word choice is clever?
Why do you feel an attachment to the word feminism? Like there are other words, egalitarian, equalist, humanist. You know, like why do you feel an attachment to that word?
Well, it's not just me. It's like the entire discourse of women's rights. Like the word feminism is very symbolic.
So why don't you call yourself, it's symbolic of a lot of things and not all of them are good, right?
That's true. Okay. I agree with that.
Here's the thing. It's a not all feminists are like that argument, right? Not all feminists are like that. Of course not all feminists are like that, right? But feminism, like mainstream feminism, scholarly feminism, right? Academic feminism, right? Movement feminism, right? So feminist organizations, right? Any feminist that matters, right, is going to be like that, right? Unless she's like Camille Paglia, who probably only calls herself a feminist to piss off other feminists, okay? Like, she only does it to piss them off. Because, frankly, when a woman says, like her says, if women had been in charge through history, we would still be living in grass huts. Okay, that's exactly what she said. And it's because of all of those things that men have done to build and maintain everything that we rely on, right? And the fact that women really don't want to do those jobs, right? The fact that the more free a society gets and the more choices women have, the more they actually gravitate away from having to do any work in the rain outside. You know, like women used to work outside in horrible conditions all the time if they were working class, right? They don't want to do that. I understand that. I don't even want to go outside to have a cigarette, right? Like, so, you know, it's cold, it's crappy out there, like why when I could be comfortable, right? But you know, like you basically have this huge amalgamous body of people who call themselves feminists who are the only ones who have any power, right? You have a certain number of power, certain amount of power. You have the power to call yourself a feminist or not. You have the power to give legitimacy to the people who have power in the movement who call themselves feminists, right? To give them legitimacy because you're a feminist, I'm a feminist, and I'm not like that, right? And you give them moral permission to keep doing what they're doing, right? And so, like, I find it really, really problematic to call yourself something like that. Feminism is not synonymous with women's rights, right? It isn't, right? It just isn't. There are so many other pet projects in there. There are so many other incredibly bizarre philosophies and concepts and theories, actually better called hypotheses, because none of them can be proven. There's no experiment that you could use. And half the things they say, the opposite happens, right? They said gender is socially constructed, right? So What's the prediction from that? Right, as I will borrow from Jordan Peterson. The prediction that you would have made 20 years ago is that as society becomes more egalitarian, the differences between men and women will get smaller, right? Say in work choice of career, right? But the opposite has happened. As society becomes more egalitarian, gender segregation in the workplace gets bigger, not smaller, right? Personality differences get bigger, not smaller, right? So the exact opposite has occurred to what they believe should have occurred, and they won't let go of the theories. They just won't, right? So I would say to you, it's been poisoned beyond redemption, the word, okay? And that's not your fault, right? But I would maybe consider identifying by another word that means the exact same thing that you believe feminism means, right? Okay? Because, and frankly, this kind of thing comes up all the time whenever somebody's discussing in general, right? Men in general, women in general. Women tend to be more likely to have a reaction that they're saying that I'm like that, right? You know, they say, if you say women are more likely to blah, 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 and you women are more likely to take it personally as a statement on them in particular rather than just in general. So that's one of those things that makes me quite valuable, I think, is that I don't do that. I have never felt any compulsion to do that. So people can talk about women in all kinds of negative ways, and I don't think they're talking about me. So there you go. Go ahead, Attila.
Karen, I'm very thankful that you do the work that you do. It is an invaluable component to the well-being of men and boys. I want to share with you an actual incident that happened to... I have two boys, 11 and 13 years old. This actually happened to my eldest son, who's in grade 8. He was in the schoolyard playing. A grade 1 girl walked up to him, slapped him across the head, and said, "You are not allowed to hit girls. You cannot hit me back." Mm-hmm. I'd like to...
Well, at least she was being honest. You know, an adult woman who would do that would probably find a way to turn herself into the victim. So...
Two parts here. One, I wanted to share this actual event. I have found that my boys are having a real difficulty at school.
Yeah.
Very inhospitable. Mm-hmm. My eldest son has been targeted by a number of events that actually, one of them led to a criminal charge based on false information.
Mm-hmm.
But the question I have for you is, what can parents, what can boys do to avoid being trapped in this condition? Like, what should my son have done?
You know, the really horrible thing is what I told my son. He was about 6, and he was they'd plowed the parking lot at the complex where I live, and they'd piled up all of this packed chunks of snow, right, all in a big pile at the end of the parking lot. And he was up there with a girl from the neighborhood when he should not have been, and she tried to push him off. And this is a fairly tall, about 10 feet tall, pile of snow, right? And so he skidded down, right, sort of on his bum, right, hurt himself a little bit, and then he threw a piece of this snow up at her because he was mad, right? And I think he had every right to be mad. And when he came in and he told me about it, he was really upset because he was scared that he was going to get really seriously hurt. And I actually told him, right, you be really, really careful what you do when you're around girls, because I still might get her mother at my door, right, to give me heck for you throwing that at her daughter, right? Like, it's not fair. It's just not, right? But you have to be aware of what other people are going to think. I know she was in the wrong. You know she was in the wrong. But any outsider coming in is going to assume that you were the aggressive one, that you were in the wrong. And it's just a fact of life that you're going to have to deal with until we can figure out a way to change it. I mean, like, that's the really sad thing, is that you just have to disabuse your kid at age 6 of any sense of fairness or justice, right, or equal treatment. You have to tell him. You know, I mean, like, that little girl who hit your son, it's the most honest thing she could say. I mean, everything she said was true.
Yeah, what astounded me is I wondered, how would a 6-year-old child learn this concept?
Oh, they know. But I mean,
where?
They see domestic violence commercials too, and, you know, and it's never okay to hit a woman, and maybe they heard it from their father when their brother was, you know, poking them, or you don't hurt girls, right? I mean, like, or their mom. It's pervasive. We teach our values to our kids. I mean, like, my dad, the only time he ever raised his voice with me was when I wasn't respecting my mother. So.
Thank you, Karen.
Thanks.
Hi, Karen.
Hi.
Thank you very much for coming here this evening.
Oh, no, you too.
My question is sort of along in the same veins. I wanted to know what you can do as a parent to encourage your children to have to be very mindful of equality, and what kind of parenting tactics we can do to nurture that sort of thinking.
You know, I think as much as possible, you know, you treat your kids equally, right? Whether they're boys or girls, as much as possible. And that doesn't necessarily mean coddling your boys. It means telling your girls that they are wearing big girl pants, right? And that there's just no way you can go around hitting people, right? And frankly, if somebody hits you back, right? If you hit a boy and he hits you back, you deserved what you got,